So thank you very much, everybody, and it's an honor and a privilege to be here. So thank you, Christiana. My name's Matthew Griffin. I'm a futurist and strategic advisor. So today I'm going to be showing you that the future is actually great in a whole variety of different ways and unexpected ways. So as a futurist, I typically look between the current day, so 2021, all the way out to 2071, the next 50 years. And the reason I do that is if you're a multinational, typically you care more about the next 5, 10, maybe 20 years. If you're a sovereign government, though, and I work with most of the G20, you typically care from kind of the modern day to 50 years out, particularly when we start talking about the future of infrastructure, energy, skills, transportation, the workforce, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So today I'm going to take you on a relatively fast ride of the future. On the one hand, just to demonstrate how many things are changing, but also to demonstrate how fast they're changing and what the opportunity is. So I work with a whole variety of different multinational organizations, helping them see the next 10 to 50 years. So organizations basically like Samsung, you're using these organizations every day. Companies like Arm, where we're looking at 2030, T-Mobile, where we look at the future of 5G, 6G, Disney with the future of entertainment and so on and so forth, Dentons with the future of law. And everything is changing. So one of the things I would actually encourage you to think about, basically, as you sort of go around your daily duties, is follow what I call the general purpose technologies. Now, this might sound like a little bit of an odd statement. A general purpose technology is a type of technology that is the bedrock and the foundation of huge amounts of future innovation across sector and everything else. So for example, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, gene editing, 5G, they are all general purpose technologies, robotics, AR, VR, immersive technologies, and so on and so forth. And the reason for this is will become clear, because if you're looking to bring investment from Europe into the UK, these general purpose technologies are the bedrock of all future products and services, the workforce as well, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, today, the world is moving faster than at any other point in time. If I asked you, and if we were actually able to meet in person, and I asked you if you think today is moving faster or slower than it did 10 years ago, certainly from the audiences that I talk to all the way around the world, about 98, 99% of them actually say that we are moving faster today than at any other point in human history. If I accelerate that question out to 2030, do you think we're going to be moving faster as a society from a technological perspective, a business or an industry perspective in 2030 than we are today? Again, 98 to 99% of people say yes. So I'm going to demonstrate just how fast we can disrupt entire global industries. Now, increasingly the world is connected. All services are increasingly digital. So if you sort of step back in time, yeah, it took 75 years for 50 million people to adopt the television and the phone and these kinds of things. It took 19 days for Pokemon Go. It took 6 days for 100 million people to download Call of Duty. And last year, we saw the release of, well, 2019, we saw the release of Facebook's Libra cryptocurrency. If Facebook, which has 2.2 billion people on it, and which in itself is essentially a form of virtual nation, which is another conversation, was able to release Libra, then 500 to 2.2 billion people could have used a new cryptocurrency within a single day. And to quote the heads of the ECB, the US Fed, the People's Bank of China, the UK Bank of England governors, Libra could have changed the financial services industry and states' control of money overnight. Overnight is the key word there. So we live in an extreme time. We live at extreme speed. Now, from a technology perspective, once we've identified as entrepreneurs a problem to solve and a value that we can deliver, we need to start combining different technologies together to create tomorrow's products and services. So this is my starburst. Traditionally, when we sort of start talking about technologies, we do talk about those GPTs. AI, 3D printing, robotics, you know, gene editing, all those kinds of things. But I track over 450 what we call exponential technologies. And every single dot on this radar represents an opportunity, a market opportunity of at least $500 billion for that particular technology. Each individual one of these individual technologies can either disrupt one industry or all of them. So for example, 3D printing, 4D printing, they disrupt the $10 trillion manufacturing industry. Bioreactors, I'm going to show you that we can solve world famine using a bioreactor. When we start having a look at biotech, we'll go into biotech in a little bit. There are some staggering breakthroughs there. If you just have a look at the COVID vaccine, it used to take 10 years to produce a vaccine, like the ones that we've seen now punched through in about 8 months, even with a sense of urgency. When we start having a look at the future of connectivity, we have 5G and 6G. We've got space internet platforms that will connect up the next 3.5 billion people. That's a huge market opportunity in itself. When we have a look at energy, basically we have renewables, basically we have 3D printed batteries, 3D printed films coming through. We have wireless technologies coming through. We'll dive into that. When we have a look at computing, Ross King and the team up at University of Manchester have developed the world's first DNA computer. So we're moving from today's computing devices to quantum computers that companies like BMW and Volkswagen are already using to reinvent their supply chains, which are 100 million times faster than any computer on the planet today. And we are already starting to see the emergence, basically, of biological computers, DNA computers, chemical computers. When we start having a look at intelligence, you know, we talk about artificial intelligence, but we've already seen the creation of DNA-based artificial intelligences, 3D printed AIs. They're called diffractive artificial intelligences. These technologies, as you can see from this wheel, when you start combining all these different technologies together, that's when you start disrupting something easily and at scale. And I can just keep going round and round and round. We have neural interfaces as well that are making inroads and significant differences in healthcare space, whether it is neuroprosthetics, whether it is helping people with ALS and neurological conditions communicate. And when we have a look at neural interfaces, we actually have paralyzed people in the US who are now using these neural interfaces to control fleets of F-35 jets. We can upload knowledge to people's minds. We did that 2 years ago, courtesy of DARPA and a couple of Japanese organizations. The future is already here. You don't just necessarily see it depending on sort of where you're looking. So as we start talking about speed, I'm going to start accelerating speed. So what if we could actually increase the innovation quotient across Europe and the UK by 100-fold? What if we could increase the rate of innovation by 1,000, 10,000, 1,000,000-fold, 100,000,000-fold? Is that interesting? We're already there. So we have the birth of creative machines. A creative machine is a type of artificial intelligence that is able to design, innovate, and then when combined with 3D printing, manufacture products at scale. And I've got examples. So today, these creative AIs, because you can turn innovation into an automated process, are typically working on iterative innovations. They take an existing product and then they sort of figure out how to modify and change it. Now, to give you an example, if we stepped back 10 years ago and I asked you to create the world's most dexterous robot hand, which, by the way, can also put out of work most of the people working in warehouses today, let alone basically have implications for robo-surgeons and all these other sort of things, it would have taken you a very, very long time and you'd need a big team. But what if I could create the world's most dexterous robot hand in under 2 days?
We're trying to build robots that learn a little bit like humans do, by trial and error. What we've done is trained an algorithm to solve the Rubik's Cube one-handed with a robotic hand, which is actually pretty hard even for a human to do. We don't tell it how the hand needs to move the cube in order to get there. The particular friction that's on the fingers, how easy it is to turn the faces on the cube, what the gravity, what the weight of the cube is, all of these things, it needs to learn by itself. The interesting thing is that kind of standard techniques in robotics haven't been able to scale to that complexity that we see in a robotic hand. Humans have evolved to be able to manipulate and operate our hands. So there's a huge amount of learning that's happened through evolution to get us to this point as a species. And the robot has to learn all of this from scratch. Instead of trying to write very dedicated algorithms to operate such a hand, we took a different approach where we create thousands of different simulated environments and learn to do the task in all of those. And hopefully, a robotic hand will be able to do it in the real world as well. This means like thousands of years of experience that this neural network has had in simulation. Every time the algorithm has gotten good at the task, we make the task harder. That's really crucial because it needs exposure to really complicated environments in order to eventually be robust to the real world. You put a rubber glove on the hand and can still carry out the task. This ability to generalize to new environments feels like a very core piece of intelligence. It really changes the way we think about training general purpose robots. Moving from thinking too much about the actual algorithms and start thinking about how do we create complex enough worlds where they can learn. At some point, then it would be more down to the imagination what robots could actually accomplish. The hope is to build robots that can do many different tasks, to increase the standard of living and give everybody a better life.
So this single technology fundamentally changes the entire field of robotics. It opens the door to self-evolving robots that are able to self-learn without human input, let alone a whole variety of other things. In addition to that, basically these creative machines accelerate research and development and innovation like never before. And that market alone is worth $1.7 trillion a year. Just the amount of money that is spent on R&D every year by global organizations and countries is $1.7 trillion. This fundamentally disrupts it. Now, when we start talking about people who are actually using these creative machines to do new things, design new things, we have Airbus who are using these creative machines to help design the new A330neos. We have InSilico, basically, that used their creative machine to design 30,000 new drugs in 21 days. We have NASA who are using these to design future spacecraft. We have Under Armour who actually used one of these virtual machines to design a fundamentally new running shoe in a day that could be 3D printed. Now, because it could be 3D printed, this meant that Under Armour's entire R&D process, which normally takes them from concept to shelf about 18 months, was collapsed to 2 days. So in other words, they could think, what do they want to create? They could use a creative machine to design these new products for them. They could use 3D printing to manufacture those products on demand. 18 months down to 2 days. You accelerate the development of hardware, you accelerate the development of all kinds of products. And as for content, these creative machines are also starting to get their heads around the content industry. So we call it synthetic media, synthetic content. You can kind of think deep fakes on steroids and so on and so forth. But the global creative industry is worth $6 trillion. It employs 235 million people. We already have artificial intelligences that are creating music that have been signed up by Warner and Sony. We have AIs that are creating procedural games. We have artificial intelligences that are writing books. The first one was on lithium-ion batteries, and it was a right snoozer. But nevertheless, when you have a look at all the content that we create, all the content that we consume, increasingly these same machines, courtesy of general adversarial networks and other sort of different technologies, are increasingly able to create stuff. Now, from a codeless future perspective and a human future perspective, this is an artificial intelligence from Stanford. if you as a human want to be able to tap into these machines, now you can just type what you want them to create. So if you want a movie or whatever it happens to be, you type what you want them to create, and these GANs will start creating the videos, the synthetic videos for you. So these ones are early generation, but they're getting better fast. Just as a little teaser. When we look at the future of agriculture, how many of you would eat a zebra? Is it ethical to eat a zebra? What if I didn't have to kill the zebra? So I said earlier that bioreactors are helping solve global famine. What if we could take one cell from a zebra or a chicken, so we could take the hair off the zebra's mane or a feather from a chicken and put it into a bioreactor and just grow meat? The meat in the chicken, who's now been regulated.
We've all been there, right? In the grocery store. Oh, I'll just buy this meat. And there it is. And all we have to do is buy it. We don't have to think about what it took to make that chicken in that nice packaging. But the reality of the way that it came about, it's incredibly unsustainable. And that's one of the biggest problems facing humanity right now. But we figured out a way to solve it. The whole idea is that that chicken in itself has an unlimited source of itself, and there is a way where you can take just a handful of cells and keep growing them essentially infinitely. For those very first cells, it was important to us how we got the cells, not just that we got the cells. We came up with the idea to use one feather from the single best chicken that we could find.
We picked out.
First thing we need to do is we need to identify a cell that we are going to use as the basic starter material. And then what we need to do is find a food for it to grow in. So we have to identify the right set of nutrients that will cause the cells to multiply, but not just multiply, but do so quickly and into high densities.
An out-of-body experience to sit there and eat a chicken, but have the chicken that you're eating running around in front of you. You don't imagine doing something like that.
So that disrupts the global agricultural industry, and which accounts for about 20% of all global greenhouse gases. That particular technology there actually limits basically the amount of greenhouse gases. When you start combining what we call clean meat, which is increasingly now an affordable product. So Singapore have just regulated the chicken to be eaten as chicken nuggets in Singapore. Clean meat technologies used to be coming in at about $1.5 million per pound of meat that they produced. 2 years ago, it was $363. The University College of London is now working on a new technology that actually lets us get that down to $5 to $15, in which case that's now supermarket competitive. Now, when we start having a look at vertical farms basically can use 99% less water, no chemicals, no pesticides. You can put them in any urban center, and we're seeing these starting to spring up in most urban centers now. You can produce 8 crops a year, and fundamentally, again, basically from a sustainability perspective, you eliminate all of the food miles that you would normally have to sort of put up with. So, for example, in the UK, most UK lettuces actually come from Spain. You know, it's a, 1,000, 2,000 sort of trip for them, 2,000 mile trip for them. So this is a manufacturing technology as well, which means that the costs start here, but the costs quickly plummet. We're already seeing fully autonomous farms coming through courtesy of companies like Iron Ox, which means that we can produce sustainable food locally, organically, and we can actually do it affordably. Now, when we have a look at the future of construction, the future of construction is dramatically different as well. Now, for example, in France, basically, and throughout Europe, we're now able to 3D print houses in under a day, so like a four-bedroom house in under a day, for around 25,000 euro. Just these technologies, that is 10 times better than anything else that we have today. So, for example, if you want to build a four-bed house in the suburbs of Paris, a traditional house will cost you about 250,000 euros. But what if robots again? It's courtesy of the UAE government. Affordable, cheap, and fast. But what about 3D printing a house with a nuclear reactor? This is courtesy of the US Department of Energy. When you can 3D print mini nuclear reactors complete with nuclear cores in a lab, you fundamentally change how you regulate the nuclear industry. You fundamentally change the cost of nuclear. So this thing just kind of keeps going. But again, you know, we are already at the stage where we are 3D printing almost functional nuclear reactors in American labs. And again, there's a whole variety of different energy technologies as well. When we have a look at the future of cyber, increasingly we can predict cyber attacks. We can investigate the deep web. We can see what exploits basically people are talking about, what exploits people are downloading, what targets they're talking about. And then we can forewarn companies that they are going to be attacked using this type of exploit by this type of group. So predictive cyber attacks. Increasingly, we're using the weaponization of artificial intelligence. So we have full-on robo-hackers, which are now being used in the US military to protect the Pentagon's core systems, courtesy of platforms called Mayhem, which is quite fitting. An artificial intelligence robo-hacker is able to scan tens of millions of lines of code. And we have companies like BlackBerry with Jarvis. We have our IBM Watson, who are sort of in these markets. They're able to scan tens to hundreds of millions of lines of code in minutes. They can find proof of vulnerabilities, and then they can either choose to exploit those vulnerabilities or patch them, depending on which side of the cyber fence that you sit on. These things are hundreds of millions of times faster than human hackers, and they are the future. Semi-autonomous and fully autonomous robo-hacking systems. We have new hardware chips coming along. This is the Morpheus chip. Courtesy, basically, of Agita Labs, basically, which is out of the University of Michigan. This is essentially a computer that can, a computer chip that can self-configure and self-reconfigure itself. It is the equivalent of a computer Rubik's Cube. And recently, 300 top-level hackers were given full access to it for 3 months, and they couldn't hack it. So we're changing the entire cyber and cybersecurity landscape. When we look at the future of energy, so today, basically, we have biofuels, we have lithium-ion batteries. When we start thinking about lithium-ion batteries, we start switching to wireless technologies. So, for example, we already have companies like Lamborghini who are developing a fully autonomous, fully batteryless hypercar, kind of by 2030. We've got the advent, basically, of hydrogen. When we have a look at grey, blue, or green hydrogen, you can pump it through the gas grid, courtesy of breakouts, basically, in California, which means that we no longer need to invest huge sums of money building out specific hydrogen infrastructure other than the hydrogen plants themselves. And there's lots of opportunity in that particular space. When we have a look at wireless energy technologies, the confluence of metamaterials, along, basically, with other different technologies, now means that in New Zealand, for example, courtesy of Enrod, we can transmit megawatt values of electricity from one point to another wirelessly. This disrupts energy grids. It also means you don't necessarily need to build a power station. You don't need to build power lines or bury power lines any longer. So when we start looking at solar, today, if you go down to any store in Europe and you go and buy a solar panel, it's a silicon-based solar panel. It's about 17% energy efficient. Again, we've already created solar panels that are 48% energy efficient using perovskite and bacteria and carbon nanotubes. That's a whole other story there. If we use black silicon, we can create a solar panel, and these are now in the labs, we can create a solar panel with 132% efficiency. In addition to that, if you take these solar panels and you put a layer of graphene over the top of them, these are here today, you can generate clean energy basically when it is cloudy, thanks to bacteria. You can generate electricity from rain and snow, because when rain falls on a solar panel, it touches the graphene, creates a charge, and you can capture that. And you can also capture electricity at night. So for example, using 3D printing and nanophotonic materials, which have capture all the very small wavelengths of light, you can now have a lunar panel. So that fundamentally changes not only the cost of solar and renewables, but it also means that you can use them anywhere, basically whether it's the Arctic Circle or whether it's the UK or whether it's the Sahara. When we look at the future of wellness, by 2028, the vast majority of biotech and healthcare companies reckon that we will reach something called escape velocity. Escape velocity is the point in time where we will have the technology to add more than a year's worth of life to humans for every year that they've lived. Some of these technologies include things like being able to 3D and 4D print human organs. So across Israel, Europe, and the UK, we're already using 3D printed organs, bones, corneas, skin, etc., in hospital operations. But recently, we've been able to 3D print a functional and beating genuine human heart, which is about this big. But remember, over time, technology gets better, its cost performance plummets, and it gets more ubiquitous. So a few years ago, you wouldn't have been able to 3D print a genuine human heart. In about 5 to 7 years' time, these 3D printed hearts basically will be human size. And then in 10 to 15 years' time, you'll be able to transplant them once the regulators get their heads around them. In vivo gene editing, when we take technologies like CRISPR and Cas, we can put people who have no future. So we recently put a chap who has Hunter's syndrome onto an intravenous drip. The good news that you have with Hunter's syndrome is that you are going to die painfully in 20 years. It's an inherited genetic disease. The bad news is you're going to die painfully. So we put this Hunter's patient in the US, basically onto an intravenous drip and fed essentially a genetic engineering tool via the drip. That tool clipped out the bad genes, clipped in good genes. He's now recovered. So we are already at the point where we can genetically re-engineer the human genome in living patients. That cures over 6,000 inherited genetic diseases. Tricorders. When we start talking about using these, you combine artificial intelligence and machine vision with one of these. This is increasingly a tricorder. If I talk into it, it can start diagnosing me for PTSD, dementia, depression, and all kinds of things. The way that I hold it, you again can tell my mental health. I can use the camera on this, especially to identify pancreatic cancer, because when you have pancreatic cancer, you end up with yellowy eyes. I can identify skin cancer. I can even tell whether or not I have COVID by using artificial intelligence and the microphone, because when you get COVID, your voice box changes. So you can do some amazingly interesting things when we start looking at primary and secondary healthcare. And then when we start looking at the future of work, so one of the things that we sort of talk about, basically from an investment perspective, is bringing jobs, for example, to the UK. Now, on the one hand, basically we're seeing the rise of fully autonomous organizations. We have them coming out of Hong Kong. We have them on Wall Street. They're predominantly communications and financial services organizations that are fully autonomous, like hedge funds and so on and so forth. But when you start having a look at the tech giants, basically they are going to be rolling out product after product that is increasingly automated, autonomous, and they're going to disintermediate everything. Now, for example, what if I said to you that from a UK perspective, you could actually create a center of excellence that allows you to bring all of the world's surgeons into the UK so that they can perform surgeries remotely on anyone, anywhere on the planet using robo-surgery techniques and teleoperations and telepresence techniques using 5G robotics.
其实5G呢，就是让我们可以做到在很多场合，比如说救灾的场合，还有一些像边防上，还有一些呢，就是说像我们将来的基层和大型医院的连接，我们完全可以做到，就是让外科医生做的一个标准化的术士，一个人可以去做几千公里，或者是那个几百公里，各种各样的这样点对点的一些连接。
So that's where you can have a surgeon in one place in the world operating on somebody who's in another place in the world. However, what if I said that we could apply the same teleoperations and telepresence technologies to do exactly the same with construction? What if we could have someone in one place building buildings on a completely different continent? So again, teleoperations, 5G, and a variety of other drone machines make that possible.
Moving on to other stories now, South Korea is aiming to become one of the leading players of the 5G industry. We already have a head start in employing smart manufacturing solutions using the technology to remotely control machinery on other continents. Oh Seong brings us part one of our special series.
A 40-ton excavator at a construction site in Germany can be controlled from over 8,500 kilometers away in the South Korean city of Incheon. Earlier this month, Korean construction giant Doosan became the first firm in the world to remotely control machines on the other side of the planet. Running on-site operations through live video streaming, 3D machine guidance and real-time diagnostics doesn't just save time and money, but also enables remote handling in dangerous situations, such as the disposal of toxic materials.
A human worker can step in when necessary, remotely and efficiently handle multiple machines at once.
Smart factory solutions are one of the main sectors of application for the 5G wireless network, with data speed reaching 20 times faster than LTE and near zero lag time of 1 millisecond. It's expected to breathe life into the manufacturing sector, which makes up one-third of Korea's GDP. According to the startup ministry, nearly 8,000 firms last year with smart factory solutions saw productivity increase by 30%, while reducing the number of faulty items by 44%. The number of on-site accidents also fell by 22%. This local firm in Central Seoul has been developing smart displays and glasses based on augmented reality. Real-time data feeds through the lenses, providing guidance throughout the factory with crucial details such as inventory levels or instructions you have to follow.
So, for example, this is where you can combine robotics with artificial intelligence, machine vision, sensor technologies, 5G, to build different things on different planets, on different continents. And those buildings, by the way, could actually be designed by an artificial intelligence as well. Now, when we have a look at Future Human, we're changing basically literally the concept of human presence. Digital humans are humanity.
Hi, I'm Will. I work at Vector helping young people learn about renewable energy. Here's what happened when I met some students for the first time. I can help you become an energy expert. What should we start with?
Geothermal genius.
Magma from the Earth's core comes closer to the surface and we end up with volcanoes, hot springs and geysers. But do you know what magma is?
Molten rock from the outer core.
Absolutely right.
I thought Will was really, like, fantastic.
Like he's there looking at us. Like, it's like a real human.
Here's a quick question for you. What do you think is the windiest city in the world?
Wellington.
Nice. If the sun is so far away, how long do you think it takes sunlight to reach us?
10 minutes.
Correct. You're a solar superstar. I was curious if they liked me.
It's different from, like, talking to Will than talking to, like, Siri, for example, because, like, he's there, you can see him.
He was quite human-like, even though he's an AI.
Then, the human version of me arrived.
How's it going?
Is it cool?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was cool. We got some really good reactions out of a few kids.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah. A couple of them didn't recognize me straight away. You know it's me, eh?
Oh, yeah, true. I can see that now.
It's a bit of a shock seeing my digital avatar for the first time. It's like looking in the mirror, I guess.
Let's face it, he may look like me, but I'm the one who knows about energy.
Yeah, I think.
So Will has taught 250,000 children about energy. And if you start thinking about taking some of these creative technologies, you can now have a digital human as a pop star, as a movie star, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then when we start talking about the future of transport, and we're almost there, consider this. When you take the steering wheel, when you take the dashboard, and when you take the pedals out of a car, you don't have a car any longer. The car is dead. Toyota see this. Audi see this. You have a pod. And just to give you a weird example, when you have a pod, you can create a fully autonomous hotel room, let alone fully autonomous shops and all kinds of different things. So when we're starting to talk about cars and the automotive industry, don't think about that. Think about the fully autonomous pods. And then finally, just to leave you with this, so this has been flight tested 70 times. It's due about 2024. Courtesy of SpaceX, how would you like to commute from one part of Europe to the other in this way, in minutes? So disruption is everywhere, opportunity is everywhere. And as for the future, you're already living it. So I hope you enjoyed the presentation and thank you for watching.